the outback where UNITA operated. So in choosing that title, I'm trying to give a sense of the global and the local. Previously, most of my research on Angola has concentrated on the local and the national level. I'm interested in the ideologies of the conflict, not ideologies in the sense of the global ideologies of the Cold War. I'm talking about ideologies as systems of meaning and discourse that political elites used to seek legitimacy, and ideologies within which people's perceptions of common interests were constituted. Obviously, there's a perception of the Angolan conflict as a proxy war. Yes, of course, we cannot deny there was external material support to both parties. But I think the problem with the proxy war model is it encourages people to read off ideological positions on the basis of external support, which gives a very misleading idea of the kind of appeals that were made by the parties within Angola. Particularly in the case of UNITA, how do we resolve the question of its links at different times with China, with the United States, and with apartheid South Africa, at the same time as it was presenting itself as a movement upholding African authenticity? In this paper, I bring in UNITA's international connections, particularly with China and South Africa, in keeping with the BRICS theme of the conference, from a different angle. I consider the relationship of these international links with the ideologies through which UNITA sought legitimacy among the people who lived under its control. Amid these apparent contradictions of its external linkages, I think the consistent strand in the ideology that UNITA deployed was one of anti-colonial nationalism. In this sense, the MPLA and UNITA I see as mirror images of each other. They fed off their own mutual antagonism. Both originated as anti-colonial movements. Echoes of anti-colonialism remained in their discourse even after the Portuguese had left Angola. UNITA saw the MPLA as the alien agent of neo-imperialist forces. The MPLA saw UNITA in the same way. In other words, each movement needed the presence of the other to legitimize itself. So how do anti-colonial movements consolidate national identity? They build states. UNITA's image of itself as a state was crucial to its self-image and to its appeals, just as it was to the MPLA, which was an internationally recognized state, which UNITA wasn't. Being a state then was about being the driver of a process of modernizing development. It was also about defining security, seeking to legitimize violence, to persuade a group of people that it was taking up arms in their interest as a community. I see foreign support in this context as how it underwrote in material terms the state-building projects on each side of the conflict and the ways in which they were understood. So I'll start by looking at South Africa's relationship with UNITA. Obviously, it starts with the Portuguese Revolution in 1974, provoking great anxiety in South Africa about what's going to happen when the Portuguese leave. Pretoria, worried about the leftward inclination of the MPLA, seeks to support other movements in Angola, first the FNLA and very soon afterwards UNITA. Of course, 1975, South Africa invades to try and keep the MPLA out of Luanda. They're driven back by the Cubans. This opens the way for the MPLA to take control of the little towns of the interior of Angola, which had previously been occupied by UNITA. That happens in early 1976. A former associate of Savimbi, who I spoke to about this, recalls him saying, "We don't know how to choose our friends. The United States is not our friend. If we'd chosen the Russians, we'd be in Luanda by now." In other words, a sense of the arbitrariness of these international linkages. So as the Cubans approached the interior of Angola, UNITA left the cities, retreated to the bush. Now, it's during this period, from about March 1976 and the few years that follow that, that UNITA starts talking again about Mao and the connection with China. Now, this connection goes back to 1966-67, shortly after the foundation of UNITA, when Savimbi went to Beijing and met Mao Zedong. It was Maoist ideas of self-reliance which informed UNITA's strategies during the anti-colonial war in the bush of eastern Angola in the 60s and early 70s. So when it retreated from the towns in 1976, it justified its next move, again by drawing on this Maoist legacy. Savimbi and his followers embarked on an adventure which became mythologized in UNITA's own own history, account of its own history as the Long March. One of Sidimbi's generals, Samuel Chiwali, writes in his memoir, "The tough journey to flee from the tentacles of our executioners came to be known in the history of our party as the Long March, because of the similarity of that to that of Mao Zedong and his companions." However, the former associate of Savimbi, who I interviewed a few years ago, took a more cynical view. UNITA called it the Great March, but that was really just a question of marketing, he said. From late 1976, the MPLA is now in the possession of all the main towns of Angola, including those in the interior, where UNITA's in the countryside, not very far away. During that period of the late 70s, UNITA sets up bases in the bush. It thinks it can operate a guerrilla struggle by mobilizing among the peasantry, not far from the towns where the MPLA is building its state. It does so by setting up bases which are populated not only by soldiers but by cadres as well, offering rudimentary education and health care to the population, inculcating a fear among the local population of the MPLA, against which UNITA can offer itself as a guarantor of security. It would hold rallies aimed at popular mobilization, but it's also deriving from Mao, there's this idea of elite mobilization as well. Now, the UNITA elite came out of the mission schools, mostly the Protestant missions of the Central Highlands. There's this extraordinary incident where Savimbi decides they need more teachers and nurses, so he sends General Nunda, one of his lieutenants, not a general at that stage, to the mission to, quote, persuade these pastors and teachers and nurses to come and join UNITA at its bases. They come thinking they're coming to a visit. They soon realize they're not going to be allowed to go back. Savimbi then sends Munda to invite the wives and families of these people of the missions to come and join UNITA as well. That's how UNITA starts to build up its parallel state in the bush. Nunda explains this to me in terms of in the following terms. The Chinese Revolution taught that a guerrilla movement that wants to take power has to create support bases. This contrasted in Nunda's account with the peasantry, which was more the population where the soldiers were recruited, the population that organized food for the troops and also carried weapons for the troops. However, in the early 1980s, the war ratchets up to a new level. This is about the Reagan administration coming into power in Washington, South Africa taking a renewed interest in Angola. This prompts a new vision in UNITA of originally derived from conversation with Mao as well, the need to establish a more secure rear base, which is a long way from where the government forces are. Thus is founded Jamba, UNITA's base in the extreme southeast of Angola, located largely because its proximity to South African occupied Namibia at the time. Obviously it was strategically important, but I mean my interest in it here is about its political importance. The presence of Jamba allows UNITA to articulate an ideology that links nationalist legitimacy to a program of state building. According to interviewees who've spent time there, Jamba was almost like a city or a state within a state. Its hospitals, its schools, and its international airport were evoked by interviewees as a token of UNITA's potential as a government in waiting. They saw in Jamba the embodiment of a vision of social order and progressive modernization, which was at the heart of UNITA's internal discourse. UNITA officials acknowledged that Jamba was sustained only by the South African support that it received. However, this didn't prevent them from taking it as a symbol of UNITA's achievement. On the contrary, the fact that UNITA had foreign connections could be presented as evidence of the movement's capability and prestige. As one former soldier put it, "We were politically connected worldwide. People could go from there to the United States or to South Africa. We kept in touch with all the world. South Africa is the regional power and the US is the global power." Somebody else said, "From a certain time, we got satellite television. We could see international football in Jamba." That was also important. Another one recalled the presence of South Africa as a foreign element with technology for Angolans to develop. Outside a very small inner core of the UNITA elite, nobody with UNITA really knew what the regime was in Pretoria was all about. They'd never heard of apartheid, A lot of them didn't even know that that South Africa had a black majority population that was being oppressed by the same white government that was giving support to UNITA. However, the UNITA leadership that knew all about the regime in Pretoria was highly embarrassed by this. And when you read, you talk to people and you read memoirs, there's this constant anxiety of trying to play down the connection, to pass it off as one that was purely strategic, not ideological at all. Samuel Chiwali claims that Savimbi used the opportunity of a meeting in 1978 with the then South African Foreign Minister Pip Boerter and the Defence Minister Magnus Malan to call for the release from prison of Nelson Mandela. UNITA is always trying to present its own anti-apartheid credentials as a corrective to the image of it as a proxy of Pretoria. However, I mean, the MPLA and its sympathisers, UNITA's links with South Africa was an absolute gift. They lost no opportunity to present these links with the apartheid regime as evidence of UNITA's counter-revolutionary character. Where then are we to find the ideological character of UNITA? Jadu Makalia, another UNITA official who's written a memoir, recalls debates within UNITA between Maoists and Marxists, and he insists that UNITA was and continues to be a party ideologically of the left. Chiwale recalls Savimbi saying in 1977 that Marx had been correct to say that power must be seized from the bourgeois class and handed over to the worker and peasant class. Marxism gives us a base, but it's wrong to apply it mechanically in a socially, economic, and cultural context like ours. However, UNITA officials all echoed this, consistently echoed Savimbi's fears of Soviet expansion. This was strategic in terms of soliciting support from South Africa and the US. Savimbi, when he spoke to Western audiences, would talk about UNITA's democratic credentials, arguing that the MPLA had refused the possibility of multi-party elections that it had agreed to in 1975. And they also linked their opposition to the Soviet presence to narratives about African authenticity, which was also an important theme within UNITA's internal discourses. You know, they claimed, for example, that the MPLA had elicited Cuban and Soviet support because the MPLA was not indigenously Angolan. They were atheist Creoles from the coast who didn't speak anything but Portuguese. So what was the ideological impact of this foreign assistance from various quarters to UNITA? I mean, I'd say it had both intended and unintended consequences. The intended consequence of foreign assistance came through support for projects of state building that were central to UNITA's articulation of an ideology that it used to mobilize support in the areas that it controlled. However, with its eclectic range of foreign connections, I'd say UNITA was able to determine the terms of its political engagement inside South Africa. It didn't take a line from any of its foreign supporters. Early contact with China bequeathed to UNITA its strategies of mobilization. However, the simulacrum of state building that Jumbo represented was only possible with South African support. The unintended consequence of South African support for UNITA, as well as the Cuban support for the MPLA, was a deepening of antagonisms between the adherents of the two rival movements. As I said, UNITA's alliance with South Africa was a gift to the MPLA. Similarly, most of the former rank and file UNITA soldiers I spoke to and who'd retained their UNITA affiliation after the war were adamant that Cuba had invaded Angola, and for this reason they had joined UNITA to defend the Angolan nation. I hope I've kept the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Justin. We're now here going to hear from Chris Saunders from the University of Cape Town, who has written very widely on the kind of transnational connections of liberation movements, and today he's going to talk about Soviet and other Cold War influences on the Namibian liberation struggle.
Thanks very much. Justin didn't mention he's just published an important book on UNITA with Cambridge University Press.
Oh, thanks.
Just advertise that.
It's on sale in the foyer.
Yes, it's in the foyer.
Yeah. Okay. And right. Well, here you can get the paperback edition, which is much cheaper than one you buy in Europe or America.
So. I'd like to thank the organisers, and particularly Miles, I think, has put together these excellent panels and There was going to be a paper by somebody from Angola talking on the MPLA who dropped away, and so I'm a late addition to this panel, and I've been asked to, as you just heard, talk about the Soviet and other Cold War influences. But of course, my paper does fit into this panel because Angola is so crucial. I mean, Angola was the place where SWAPO was hosted for over 10 years, like the Katangese that we're going to hear about from Niles. You've already heard about the war that was going on there and so forth. I would argue that actually, unlike the UNITA and the Katangese we're going to hear, SWAPO, of course, achieved its aim of coming to power in independent Namibia in 1990. And the question is, how did that happen? And I would also argue that external influences were actually more important in the Namibian case, which is my case, than in any other liberation case in Southern Africa. Maybe that's provocative, but... And so there's this whole range of transnational and influences. Of course, there's the local ones. There's the South African one, which I've heard something about. SWAPO was actually established, in a sense, in Cape Town originally. There's Angola and so forth. But I want to look more at the global situation and not talk about the West at all, because in terms of this conference theme, look at the Soviet Union in particular. There is important work done on the GDR that was mentioned in the last panel, and also on the non-aligned movement, but I'm going to leave that. So let me focus on the Soviet Union, and the way that I thought I would do this is to talk about the literature, the scholarly literature. I'm not concerned with the large sort of polemical literature about the role of the Cold War, but in terms of scholarly work and how does one assess its strengths and limitations and so forth, I'm going to focus on two particular books. And the first one I was going to actually just hold up here, which Jocelyn and Alexandra, I think, mentioned earlier, and of course it's Vladimir Shubin's book on the Hot Cold War, and I'm delighted to see him in the back row over there, and I wondered why he isn't talking about this himself, but this book, of course, is drawn on his own personal involvement in the Afro-Asian Solidarity Committee and in the International Department of the Communist Party. And it's also based, in some extent, on Russian archives, although, as was pointed out in the last panel, that there's access to those is limited. So anyway, what I want to do is just make a few points about his book. Although it's called The Hot Cold War, and although it covers the whole region, in a way I've been a bit surprised not to hear more mention of this in some of the other papers about the liberation struggles in the region and the Soviet role. I mean, on Namibia, there's a section on Namibia, but there's also two chapters on Angola that sort of relate very closely to this. I want to make some comments about it. And of course, Hot Cold War suggests that maybe his main emphasis is really on the war, hot aspect of that. And to some extent, he's talking about the Soviet role. A military role, of course, which at the time wasn't really known about, but wants to make the point that it was greater than people knew, and that also, of course, the Soviet specialists who went, the military people who went to train in Angola, were not only behind the lines, but they were on the front line. And if those of you who are interested in sort of following this up more, there's now, in English, of course, for those of us who don't read Russian, there are a number of other sources. There's the younger Shubin Gennady, who edited The Oral History of Forgotten Wars, subtitled The Memoirs of Veterans of the War in Angola, which is published in Moscow. And then there are two other volumes of memoirs which have been published in South Africa, one called Bush War in Kwitokanavali last year. And there's also the diary by Igor Slykin, entitled We Do Not See It Even in Afghanistan, Memoirs of a Participant of the Angolan War. And all of these books, which mainly concern the period of the late 80s, from 1986, when most of these people arrived in Angola, to 1988, they add detail on the military role of the Soviet Union, show the extent of Soviet involvement, make clear that many of those whom the Soviet Union sent to Angola took an active part in military operations, serving on the front line in Kwitokanavali and elsewhere. But still, of course, there are gaps in this. If you really want to know about the role of SWAPO and how it was trained and what weapons it was supplied with, you won't find anything in really much in those volumes. I want to now just lost my page here. Go back to what I was talking about, and this is Shubin's book, which I was saying is quite largely concerned with the military role of the Soviet Union, but I want to talk about the diplomatic role, because of course, as Shubin correctly says, there were all sorts of different roles. There was the visits by Trump and other people to Moscow, there's the diplomatic role of the, and he shows in his book the growth of support for SWAPO in the Soviet Union in the 1960s onwards, from about the middle of the 1960s, which relates to the previous panel. But what he doesn't do, and I'd be interested to hear his response to this really, is to emphasize the fact that for about a decade, the Soviet Union was really sidelined in the diplomacy around Namibia. Because just to give you a bit of the history of this, as Justin just mentioned, of course, the 1975 is when the Cubans arrive in Angola, and the South African invasion is turned around, the MPLA comes to power. Of course, that's seen as a Soviet and Cuban, of course, the Cubans were acting on their own initially, but anyway, Soviet-Cuban victory. And of course, in response to that, then the Americans got really involved and were behind the Western Contact Group, and then negotiated with South African government and with SWAPO, and came up with the Western plan for the transition to independence in Namibia, which was embodied in UN Security Council Resolution 435. And the Soviet Union could have vetoed that, but of course it didn't, because it was supported by the frontline states and SWAPO. But still, from that time onwards, then of course, as Justin also mentioned, of course in the early 1980s, you have the Reagan administration with Crocker really making the running in the diplomacy at the time, which didn't come to anything for a long time, but still eventually did. And you can read his account in High Noon in Southern Africa, which of course stresses the role of the United States. But what has come out more recently, for those of us again who only read English, is the book by the Deputy Soviet Foreign Minister, Anatoly Atamishin, which is now available in English, which shows that the Soviet Union played a really important role in 1988, although it wasn't formally a part of the negotiations that were held in that year, but it was really important in encouraging Cuba and Angola to enter the negotiations and then to make sure that the negotiations succeeded. But what's also interesting about that period, the late 1980s, is that the Soviet Union wasn't working with SWAPO closely, and in fact in early 1989, as is shown in detail in another book that's recently become available, which was based on a PhD that was done in Moscow, by a Zimbabwean diplomat who was a deputy at the United Nations and who was a leading figure in the non-alignment, shows that at that point there was the campaign at the United Nations to reduce the size of the United Nations mission that was going to go to Namibia, and the Soviet Union went along with the Western powers on that, much to the annoyance of SWAPO, and then a few months later, when there was a tragic event in Namibia in April 1989, the Soviet Union played an important role in the joint commission that persuaded the SWAPO fighters to return to Angola. He was still alive. So my point is that the role, what I really wanted to emphasize is that of course the role and influence of the Soviet Union differed in terms of different forms, but also differed in time. I want to just very quickly, because I know time is so limited, talk about the ideological influence which has come up before of the Soviet Union. I agree with Justin that SWAPO was really like a UNITA, that it was willing to accept any help from anybody. But of course, also, as was mentioned, different people within the organization have different positions, but still, on the whole, the influence of the Soviet Union on SWAPO seems to me to be really quite limited. I think the UN official who said that Sam Yoma, if he met Marx in the street, wouldn't recognize him was perhaps being unfair, but And certainly it's also true that the Swapo political program in 1976 talked about the goal of scientific socialism, but this was really rhetoric. And already by 1982, Swapo had accepted constitutional principles which provided for multi-party democracy. And before 1998, it was committed to basically a mixed economy. Anyway, what I want to now do is turn to a second book, which has more recently come out, and that is Pierre Iglesias's Visions of Freedom. And this is a general study, or claims to be. If you look at the subtitle, it talks about Havana, Pretoria, Washington, and so forth. But of course, this is very much seen through the eyes of the lens of the Cubans. And I wrote a review article in the in JSS at the end of last year, which put forward some of my criticisms of this book. And basically, I argue, for example, that it's quite wrong on South African aims in Angola in the period before 1988. The aim wasn't to put Zimbabwe into power, it was impossible, the Cubans there anyway, and also about the reasons for the why the negotiations took place in 1988, which were very importantly related to what happened in Peter Potomali and the movement of the Cubans down to near the Namibian border, but the other factors are also important, which he neglects. So what coming to a conclusion, as I've just been asked to do, let me say that we've got some valuable books now on this theme, Schubin's book and Glaser's book, but what we need is, I think, a more balanced approach in a way, trying to get away from a sort of heroic narrative of either the Soviets or the Cubans. Well, once a more general study on Namibia, on Cold War influences, and whether or not these did actually delay independence, which is the usual argument, or in some ways maybe promoted it because Swapo was able to play off East and West and the role of the non-aligned movement and so forth. I think that the real reason why Namibian independence was delayed for so long was, of course, South African government wasn't prepared to give it. It wasn't related to the Cold War directly. And then, of course, the whole question of the legacy. Did the Cold War encourage the authoritarianism maybe in Swapo after independence? If you look at Roger Southall's book on liberation movements in power, or Henning Melba's recent book on understanding Namibia, you'll find that they don't tackle this. And also, just to mention one other book that's recently come out by a rich political scientist, Richard Dale, on Namibia's War of Independence, he doesn't really give attention to the Cold War. So what we need is more attention to the role of the Cold War in the Namibian case, but also in general in Southern Africa. So I think there's a lot more work for historians to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Wonderful. Okay, we've got our third and last paper. Miles Larmer, who's going to represent two authors here. He hails from Oxford, and the title is The Katangese Gendarmes in Angolan Exile.
Yeah, my co-author, Erik, kind of sends his apologies from Kinshasa. I have 15 minutes to try and persuade you that a movement you've almost certainly never heard of tells us something about the questions of national liberation and the Cold War. You've probably never heard of it. This is a movement sometimes known as the Katangese Gendarmes, later as the Fiesh, later as the Katangese Tigres, also as the National Front for the Liberation of Congo. A movement understudied, I think, because it acted against and across boundaries which tend to define our understanding of this period, across the Cold War ideological divide, across the borders of nation states, and across definitions, conventional definitions of, for example, what a national liberation movement looks like. This group was, I'm going to talk about their relations to the political powers in control, particularly of Angola, in the colonial and the post-colonial periods. And I'm going to do this sort of to start with in a sort of chronological way. The background of this is that this group has its origins in the Katangese secession from Congo in June 1960, an unrecognized Katangese state, fights against the Congolese state and UN forces with an army led by Belgian and later mercenary soldiers, but with a rank and file formed with young men from southern Katangese communities that clashes with UN forces as they advance into Katanga, ending the secession in 1963, and very briefly, after an uneasy integration into the Congolese National Army, they mutiny against President Mobutu's centralization of power and move into exile in Angola in 1967, where, shorn from their political and mercenary leadership, they're deployed in the late 60s and early 1970s as an auxiliary force in Portugal's war against Angolan nationalists. For the Katangese, this was in part a continuation of their war against what they regarded as the illegitimate Zairean state and Mobutu's backing of holding Roberto's FNLA. In the initial period in the late 1960s, the Portuguese promoted the idea of a renewed Katangese independence, at least rhetorically in some respects, but following Moise Tshombe's detention and then death in Algeria in 1969, there is an increasing emphasis on their deployment as one of these auxiliary loyalist forces against the FNLA and increasingly the MPLA. From 1969, increasingly effective MPLA forces lead to an increased operational role for these forces. They're given military instruction, they're given salaried employment, and this distinguishes them from some of the other African loyalist forces that the Portuguese had at their disposal. However, this is clearly a Faustian pact. The price of increased military effectiveness and pay was closer integration into Portugal's colonial armed forces and a reduction of their focus on a war against Mobutu. We talk in the paper about the key role played by their leader from 1969, Nathaniel Mbumba, who transforms them into a significant military force and also establishes this political platform seeking to achieve a kind of autonomy from Portuguese control, symbolized in the adoption of this name, the National Front for the Liberation of Congo. Mbumba successfully negotiates improved supplies and pay and commando training. And this is what transforms this group called the Fiesh, the faithful ones as they were known, into the Tigres, a fully fledged commando force that was regarded by the Portuguese as effective when it fought in autonomous circumstances. In other words, it operated as a singular military force with only limited control by the Portuguese. The Portuguese recognized this. Its military capacity and sought to deploy it, but were wary about its own political aims. The extent to which this political independence or autonomy was achieved can be gauged by what happened after the Portuguese Revolution. Whereas many of all the other loyalist forces were dispersed or sent into exile, the Tigres, aided by the leftist Portuguese governor after the Portuguese Revolution, Admiral Rosa Coutinho, transfer their allegiance to the MPLA in the midst of the war for independence. 1974, they signed the COSSA Accords, December 1974, an explicit quid pro quo that in exchange for fighting with the MPLA, they would be allowed to use Angolan territory as a base for attacks on Zaire with the aim of liberating their Katangese homeland. In the paper, we talk and make a case for the relative military effectiveness of this force of around 4,000 highly trained forces, particularly before the arrival of Cuban forces in late 1975. We talk about a number of the conflicts they were involved in and their role in the particularly important battle for Kiefangondo in November 1975. But casualties for this force were extremely high, essentially 4,000 soldiers reduced to around 1,600 because of fatalities in fighting. They continue to be important in the fighting after independence in November 75 and 1976, and there's clearly evidence that this group was provided with, they were regarded, continue to be regarded by the MPLA as a significant military asset. Training provided by Cubans and the re-equipment of this force by Soviet weaponry. But Cuba was clear that whilst this group now began to present itself increasingly as Marxist, as performing a kind of Marxist orientation, Cuba read this group very much as tainted by the Tshombist secessionist past and therefore refused to provide the large-scale military aid, tanks, anti-aircraft artillery that this movement, that the FLNC requested to overthrow Mobutu. So the picture here is, I would argue, a relatively conservative Cuba that prioritized protecting its gains in southern Africa and refused to support the only military force capable of advancing an anti-Mobutu case. The FLNC it did indeed launch two wars in 1977 and 78 against the Zairean state. March 1977, there's a sort of war of recruitment, but which does create a crisis because of the abject failure of the Zairean army to resist their advance into Zaire, into Katanga. And what I think is important here is whilst Cuba is representing this group as a fundamentally a group of neo-colonial Katangese Shombists, in the Western media, and particularly in Western military intelligence, this group is being read as essentially like a Maoist, Marxist guerrilla movement. French military intelligence of this period likens them to the Viet Cong, fish swimming in the water of the people of Katanga. In other words, the Cold War framing for both sides, I think we argue, makes it impossible for either side to really understand what is important to this group, which is fundamentally a kind of national liberation. Mobutu takes advantage of this, argues that this is certainly a force deployed by Cuba, Angola, and ultimately the Soviet Union, and seeks Western support in his aid. I think that the key difference here is to be able to distinguish between, certainly in the aftermath of the First War, there is significant training provided for this force, but this is training being provided for the defence of Angola rather than the advance of struggle into Zaire. And training is being read often by Western observers, in this case, as direction. It must therefore, if Cuban training is being provided, Cubans must be in control of this movement. It's very clear, in fact, that this movement is strongly resisting control by Cuba and Angola. And in the launching of its second war in 1978, it's clear that this war occurs entirely outside Cuban approval. Indeed, its leader, Mbumbo, once it's begun, is put under house arrest in Angola, and there's a desperate attempt to curtail this conflict. The attack in May 1978 leads to the seizure of the town of Kolwezi, essentially the heartland of Zaire's mineral industry, entirely destabilizes the Zairean economy, and really is the biggest threat to Mobutu's position in control of Zaire until he falls in 1997. Once again, we see this rhetoric around the Cuban backing for this. Zaire's foreign minister claimed that white faces, i.e. Cuban faces, had been seen amongst the Katangese fighters. This was a force the UN, Zaire's UN representative, suggested was armed and supported by the Luanda government under the instigation of Soviet Cuban imperialism. As I've suggested, Cuba clearly sought to prevent this attack. Glaces talks about this in detail, and Angolan President Neto stated publicly that Angola was alien to this movement. It was an internal Zairean matter. What occurs in May 1978 to turn this around is essentially a Western military intervention. The French Foreign Legion parachutes into Kolwezi, backed by Belgium and certainly US logistical support and approval of this force. And on all the Western sides, by the US, by the French, there's a desperate attempt to show evidence of direct Cuban involvement, but it's clearly not available. And you know, you have this sort of interesting sort of position of President Carter castigating the Soviet Union for its interference in the internal affairs of African nations, having just effectively green-lighted this intervention by the French Foreign Legion. But what's clear is this is a force which is destabilizing Cold War relations on both sides. And in the aftermath of this attack, the FLNC is dismantled by Angola as a political force. Its troops are moved away from the Zairean border. Its leadership is expelled from Angola, mainly to Guinea-Bissau. And this is clearly the result of pressure from both the Angolan and the Zairean states, but backed by superpower agreements. And under superpower auspices, there is a sort of detente between Angola and Mobutu during this sort of period. The Katangese troops were subsequently integrated in a decidedly problematic way into Angolan army forces, where they and their successors remained over the next 20 years or so, and some of their number go on to participate in the AFDL's successful overthrow of Mobutu in 1997. And I can talk about some of that later period if people are interested in it. But my aim here is to really focus on these different phases of the colonial and post-colonial Angolan states' relations with and characterization of this particular force. I think it tells us first a little bit more about Portugal's use of a range of African forces in its Angolan, its colonial wars, but recognizing that some of these were not of Angolan origin, for example. It tells us that the MPLA at its moment of military success was dependent not only on Cuban forces and Soviet equipment, but also some of the same foreign forces that its Portuguese predecessors had had utilized. We try and argue in the paper that this is more than what might be termed, and perhaps easily understood as simply a mercenary force, a guns for hire sort of force. It's clear that both the Portuguese and later Angolan authorities recognised that its effectiveness, and it was always recognised as a highly effective military group, rested on its deployment as a unified force with an autonomous organisation in which its commanders motivated its troops politically in relation to Congolese political identity and this notion of a liberation of Katanga in some respects from Mobutu's rule. So there's a sort of dilemma here in this hosting relationship. Autonomy necessary to deliver military effectiveness, but carrying with it the risk of autonomous political or military action, which destabilized the political environment both within countries and in the wider Cold War context. It had the potential to turn, in these circumstances, the Cold War hot in certain parts of Africa. I think that's the last thing I want to really talk about, really. I think I'll stop there because I know that I'm out of time, and if you have questions, I'll be happy to take them. Thank you.
We have about 25 minutes before we'll have a coffee break, so that's a nice chunk of time to discuss in. I think these papers, and perhaps above all Miles's last paper there, underline the complexity of the relationships we're trying to get a handle on very, very effectively. The complexity of relations with hosts, of movements, goals, of ideological influences, of the relationships among the backers, and the shifts in all of those over time. I mean, it's extraordinarily complicated and difficult to get a handle on. It does really undermine some idea of a set of national struggles being supported by clear-cut backers who are on one side. You know, that picture sort of falls apart as soon as you look at any of these movements, and particularly the cases we have in this panel. Nonetheless, the idea of national liberation survives very powerfully, regardless of all that. And that's an interesting quandary to think about. Chris also raised the legacy question, referring to Milburn's work and Roger Southall's book, which of course Roger Southall's book looks at the whole range of Southern African liberation movements, and we haven't really talked about that in depth, so that may be something we'd like to address here too. But let me throw the floor open and gather up a set of questions, and we'll go on from there. Yes?
Question for Jocelyn. You mentioned this UNITA's employment of discourses of authenticity, especially this notion that the mestizos and asimilados in Luanda were not truly African. It's interesting, because similar discourses were employed by Nito Alves during the coup attempt in 1997.
Sorry, by whom, sorry?
Nito Alves.
Nito Alves, yes.
Which is, I guess, an internal MPLA contestation. And it was both racial but also class, in the sense that slum dwellers versus the middle class, as perhaps UNITA might say, it's the representative of the peasants as opposed to the urban-based elites in Luanda. Have you explored the similarities between the two sort of, I guess, conflicts, one between UNITA and the MPLA, but also within the MPLA between, let's say, its more slum-dwelling elements or lower-class elements and its middle-class leadership?
Any other questions?
This is a bit half-formed, but I was interested in the way that Justin's and Miles's papers spoke to each other around questions of what territory does here, what territory means. Justin, I enjoyed your brief discussion of Jambo, is that right?
Yeah.
And the questions it raises about UNITA's legitimacy as a controller of territory, or an entity that is seen to hold territory, versus an entity that is seen to provide services. And of course, they're not separable here. They are the same thing, as you pointed out. But I'm just interested in how that balance is presented. And Miles, in your paper, obviously the whole thing is, in the long run, imagined as eventually the control of territory. But it all comes to a head around this town, this one town, which you mentioned, but I would love to hear more about the way that was presented as, again, maybe territory versus the holding of wealth or controlling possibilities of accumulation.
Any final questions?
And I've got a linked question specifically for Miles, which perhaps builds slightly on that. I'd like to hear you talk a little bit more about the culture of power, if that makes any sense. You said something about ideology and the force of nationalism as something that sustained them over time. But given the whole wealth of different training inputs by different regimes and different external influences, can something more be said about organisational or other sorts of cultures of power? And maybe it is related to territory, I don't know.
I agree. I mean, I haven't done any research myself on Nito Alves, but my friend Lara Pawson, who brought out a book about this recently, makes this point very eloquently. The idea of class divisions also expressed in terms of race within the MPLA. You know, I think it has to do with Luanda. Once the MPLA got rid of the FNLA in 1975, Luanda becomes exclusively an MPLA space. Therefore, any kind of contestation of power and authority within Luanda gets is articulated as a debate within the MPLA. Whereas the conflict between UNITA and the MPLA obviously plays out on a national scale in a national territory over which the MPLA never had complete control until 2002. And this relates quite neatly to Max's question as well, how the control of territory plays into UNITA's sense of itself as a state, as legitimate in the eyes of its followers. I mean, it's there in its discourse, this talk of the free lands of Angola, as they call it, the maps that it produced showing the consolidated lands, which were the areas beyond the reach of the MPLA, and how the front line changes. And there's a shaded areas on the map showing where UNITA had bases in the bush, as opposed to the consolidated lands where the MPLA could never set foot. So it was about territory, but you know, this idea of stateness, which I use quite a lot, is interesting. And stateness, yes, it's about the control of territory, but it's also about the control of people. The fact that you need people as a referent in order to make a nation. And yeah, this whole complex of nation, state, territory, people go together.
I think perhaps the Justin and I talked about this a couple of times, thinking about the sort of similarities. I think probably the difference is that in the Katangese case, the nation rather than the state is uppermost. You know, these are not people who can easily aspire to control the state, but they're very much focused on an imaginary nation that is associated certainly with, I mean, the whole Katangese succession is predicated on mineral wealth, on the idea of the legitimacy of local control of mineral wealth, and the fear that it will be controlled and, if you like, taken away and arbitrarily controlled by Congoville after independence. Minerals appear on the Katangese flag in symbolic form in this way. And so I think the seizure of Kolwezi is, in a sense, an attempt to retake the centre of mineral wealth and power. I wouldn't push it too far from. I mean, it's clearly a tactical thing more than an attempt to establish a sort of capital of a immediate new exile state. And they don't go back. They don't go to Lubumbashi, which is a sort of provincial capital. They hit the centre of the mining industry, and I think that's a relatively sort of pragmatic issue. But definitely, mineral wealth and legitimacy and usage as a basis of nation building is very important in this regard.
Just to clarify, I just want to emphasize, UNITA was never secessionist. What it aspired to was control of the whole of Angola.
Yeah, no, that's right. There's absolutely clear difference there. I mean, I think in terms of Joe's question, you know, this movement definitely takes very different forms in different periods. It's often organized more as a military organization than any sort of. I think what tantalizes me about it is that my view is, I guess, provocative view, is that it makes very little pretense to be a people's movement, a liberation movement. Leftist Congolese activists who are in exile in Brussels and Paris arrive in Angola in the mid-70s to try and make common cause with this movement, and they're kind of appalled about the fact that it doesn't pretend to be Maoist and it doesn't pretend to be liberating the people. It's clearly a highly militarized organization. What I would say, however, is that my suspicion is that the experience of its rank and file fighters was in many cases not very different to the experience of ANC exiles in Angola, for example, in a similar sort of period. I think about Steve Davis's work on the tensions between ANC leaders, ANC guerrillas and Cuban commanders, a sort of sense of racial inequality and hierarchy within camps over resources. And I suspect that for some of the individual fighters, if we want to think about the lived experience of some of these fighters, it actually, the culture of power in practice wasn't very different. It was highly authoritarian, accusative. People were certainly executed and detained for dissent, and it was a very rigid, dogmatic organization. What it lacked was the kind of Marxist-Leninist rhetoric or language from most of this period, which certainly surrounded and was perhaps believed in by many of the commanders of many of the national liberation movements.
Did you want to comment on any of that?
Only that you use this term imaginary community, but they were actually wanting to recreate the Katanga that has actually been there.
It was a debate within the movement. I mean, you can clearly see that at a certain stage, this portrayal of a National Front for the Liberation of Congo is an attempt to reconstitute Congo in decentralized form. So there's definitely debate in the movement. There's also an extroversion in Daniel's term to what seems politically possible. In the early 1970s, talking about Katangese secessions, in a sense, internationally illegitimate, so talking about a liberation of Congo. So it was possible to think about the liberation in different forms, and for it to take potentially different forms. It was a debate within the movement, but also one that had an eye to what were the political realities at any particular time.
Okay, any further questions? Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I'd like to come back, I guess, mainly to just in the context of UNITA. And I think one of the things that I've been reflecting on through the session is that UNITA, perhaps more than almost any of the other movements in the Angolan context, was much more of a sort of chameleon in some senses. And I think it's helpful not to think of it in a unitary sense that perhaps implicitly rather than explicitly you've sort of alluded to it, because I think in some parts of the country membership and affiliation was very opportunistic and varied from time to time, particularly after the effective eclipse of the FNLA, but also in fringe areas around the sort of Mbundu heartland, if you like. And I'd probably give a bit more credence to some of the cross-border currents and counter-currents as well, which really helped to define not only the sort of Jumba territory and other, you know, liberated areas, as you call them, at different times, but crucially sustained not only UNITA, but the nature of that conflict and the way in which the South Africans built up UNITA in the first place out of relatively little as a sort of tool against SWAPO, but then that strategy sort of morphed at various times, as Chris alluded to, I think. And similarly, in other parts of the country, where it was shifting allegiances, some of it was opportunistic, but ironically, of course, dominated by the overblown persona of Savimbi himself, to the point where, for at least a decade, we knew there would be no solution to the problem in Angola until Savimbi was gone. And literally, within weeks of his death, that's exactly what happened. There was a peace agreement. So I think we need a few more dimensions to it. It sort of came across, perhaps inadvertently, as a bit flat and homogeneous.
Any other questions?
This is a question to Miles, really. I found your presentation fascinating for a number of reasons. I think that the period that you discuss is also one of the, if you like, the second phase of independence. So there's movements that are taking place on the continent that are self-consciously critical of the failure of the first wave of independence that was limited in terms of the real hopes for emancipation that spoke to some elements of those early movements. And yet we have this movement that you describe, you know, largely as a military organization. One speaking of liberation, shorn of ideological content. But I wonder whether it actually had a discussion with itself about the failures of Congolese independence. And it's not the failure that typically we might look at, but it's the failure around the discussion with Katanga and Lumumba at that point of independence, when for a period Lumumba, and then in a variety of different forms, Mobutu won. You know, so how is that reflected in the discussions in the backbone of politics that has to, at some level, form the politics of the movement that you're discussing?
A last question from
anyone? Yeah, I'd like Chris Saunders maybe to say something more about, you know, the geopolitical aims of the Soviet Union. That's what I was hoping for, because I missed that in the last session, because I think maybe we need a more thorough critique, you know, of the political influence, you know, the political methods, the theories, the project, you know, in South Africa, the two-stage theory. You know, I heard Miles talk about this group, I mean, being kind of ruthless, you know, against its own dissidents, which are some of the methods of the Southern Communist Party in the ANC camps. And also what I think was the holding back of a more left revolutionary project. I think Miles says suddenly, you know, there's a super party, let's, you know, chuck this group out, you know. So, you know, the influence wasn't benign. And then just a small point on Savimbi, you know, in the 80s, you know, in South Africa, at least popularly, you know, Savimbi was called Judas Savimbi, you know, he was the utmost traitor, you know. So today I'm getting a more nuanced view. Okay, you know, that's the point of academia, but you know, I'm just surprised that he was at any point, you know, a good guy, or he wasn't sure where he stands. Yeah.
I'm going to throw in one last question, and then we're going to just let you all reply, and that will be the end of the session. My last question is just: does it matter how imaginary these imaginaries are? I mean, some of them seem very implausible sorts of imaginaries. And partly, I'm thinking about, you know, our work on Zebra. I mean, Zebra is you know, a very plausible movement with a deep root in the country it's fighting for. You know, it has political structures throughout Zimbabwe. It's, you know, you can't remotely say that about these sorts of movements. And it doesn't seem very plausible that they would eventually get there. So just to think a little bit before we start talking about imaginaries as if they confer legitimacy unproblematically, you know, how do they become plausible?
I agree. You need a chameleon like. I think there were certain things I couldn't get across in this very short presentation. I'll tell you what I have done and what I haven't done. My research on Angola has been concentrated. All my interviews were done in the Central Highlands. One more BA, the northern part of Wida, which was UNITA's heartland. A lot of the people, some of the people I talked to were peasant farmers who spent all their lives in that region. Others were of the UNITA cadre class who had gone to Jamba and had then been resettled back in the Central Highlands after the end of the war. So, you know, that's a certain slice of UNITA that I'm looking at. I don't deny that if I've been doing my research in Mushiko, in Weej, in Jambu's Kwanu Kubanga, but, you know, with the sort of non-migrant population of Kwanu Kubanga, with the indigenous population of Kwanu Kubanga or Kuneni, I might have heard different things. And I do frame my conclusions in that way. I'm talking about Central Angola. I think what didn't come across in the paper, but which does come across in my work, is the very contingent character of political affiliation. The extent to which loyalty to UNITA, particularly for the peasant farmers, was only because UNITA happened to be there. You had to be part of UNITA because that was how you saved your own skin. And that point I do make at some length elsewhere. Savimbi as Judas, was he ever good? I mean, you know, having grown up in apartheid South Africa myself, I grew up with this image of John Savimbi as a puppet of apartheid as well. You know, as someone who was against apartheid, I also despised him. It was only when I went to Angola that I realized it was more complicated than that.
Is anybody ever good? I would hesitate to
say. Yes!
Sorry. Is any despotic political leader, which I won't deny he was, ever good? I think the more relevant question is that a lot of Angolans saw their aspirations as a nation as reflected in him. He was a very effective political mobilizer, whatever kind of judgment you put on him. If you ignore that, you're kind of writing out the experience of a lot of Angolans. Anyway, I think as South Africans, we tend to approach the rest of the region with a certain arrogance that our history is a history of the entire Southern Africa. And I think it's my work in Angola and Mozambique's kind of forced me to see it from a slightly different angle. Josh, your question, does it matter how imaginary? I think with UNITA, you have to look at the circumstances in which it was operating and what it was up against. Look at the MPLA. You know, UNITA and the MPLA both start from point zero in November 1975. They're both competing for the political imaginary of Angola. There was a point at which the MPLA was no more real than UNITA. And I think it was... most of the people who followed UNITA had never had any experience of living under MPLA rule at all. The first Angolan nationalist movement they encountered was UNITA, therefore their sense of Angolanness was filtered through UNITA. And, you know, I think for that reason, these extraordinary crowded castles in the sky, these single acre of state building they did, had some resonance.
Well, there was some discussion, as you said, in the last panel about the geostrategic sort of aims of the Soviet Union. I wish Vladimir Shuk would come in on that. But what I just wanted to say about the ANC and SWAPO camps, which of course were both in Angola, but there seems to have been really little interaction between them. And there's certainly no evidence that I've seen. There's now a very good work on the SWAPO camps by Christian Williams, which is going to be published soon. There's no evidence that there was anything comparable to what went on in the MK camps in terms of the SACP, I mean, Jack Simons and others giving these lectures in Marxist Leninism and so forth. I don't think there was anything like that. And so they're fighting the same enemy, but of course, surprisingly, they didn't work together.
I think on the question of imaginary, I think this is a question of avoiding, you know, it's very easy to see a coherence of singular movements over a 35-year period, looking back from the early 90s to assume a certain set of outcomes. I think if we look at these movements in practice, if you look at, say, the ANC in 1968, 1969, its aims look potentially extremely unrealistic. It's unlikely to succeed. I would say that one thing I didn't talk about is that the FLNC has a steady process of recruitment, like other liberation movements, of younger fighters coming from Katanga, disillusioned and opposed to Mobutu's repression of the province, to strengthen and replenish its ranks, and like the ANC in, say, 1976, bringing new ideas, bringing destabilizing ideas within the movement, which partly speaks to what Leo's question raises. I mean, I certainly think that the idea of the sort of political science idea that Africa's borders were established at independence and because secession broadly didn't succeed has blinded us to some extent from a historical point of view to the extent and fertility of alternative nationalist imaginaries, nationalisms of the mind. And we're making an assessment not necessarily on political outcomes, but on lived experience of this sort of period. We have to pay attention to losers, to movements which were not successful, that ultimately, and of course, it does depend on how you measure it and how you make an assessment. Some of these AFDL forces, later generations, in 1997, see themselves as playing a role ultimately in the overthrow of Mobutu, which for them is their 1994 in a South African sense. Yes, it doesn't lead to a sort of a fully liberated Katanga, but it does lead, and it comes back to Trevor's point about, you know, next to Savimbi, Moise Tshombe stands as one of the great figures of repression within many of these liberation movements. Today, in Lubumbashi, there is a statue of Moise Tshombe put up by the governor, Moise Katumbi, as a reflection of the greatness of the success of the Katangese secession of the early 1960s, a period fondly, nostalgically, arguably inaccurately remembered as a great period of nationalist success. So, you know, as historians, we must be alive to the kind of periodization and you know, not sort of assume that. Anyway, yeah, I think that's
interesting. Okay, I think that's a good point to stop on as well. I just see, Chris, I think you're going to be very pleased because that during the next two sessions, Badenu Shubin is going to have lots of space to tell us what he thinks about all kinds of things. So the next session is going to be Badenu Shubin and Dr. Dibengwa in a roundtable discussion, talking about their own personal involvement in these struggles, and they both play very.
Two persons not enough.
Well, we lost our third one.
So
there's any more participants around? They can jump in. So we're going to break for coffee now, but I think we should thank our speakers.